gonna be a big one. You can see how many couches we have on stage. Are there any Harry Potter fans here? Make some noise! Oh, you can do better. Are there any Harry Potter fans in the house? Make some noise! Ladies and gentlemen, I'll give you a lineup of 10 people. Give it up for our first one, Afshan Azad! Let's start with you. Devin, sorry. Let's start with you. Yeah, because you're holding the gray mic. Yeah.
It's terrible. We actually, nobody gets on in real life, so it's kind of awkward this weekend. I know, it's really good. We don't get to see each other quite as often as we'd like, and it's great to kind of meet up and reminisce, and it's kind of strange. Although we haven't seen each other in so long, that when we're together, we just kind of pick up as if we were just filming last week.
I can imagine, yeah. And it's so Alfred, you were actually in the reunion special. What was it like, you know, reflecting on that time? And like Devin said, like it's been like yesterday that we last wrapped up.
It doesn't always feel like yesterday just because I feel old. And then I look at some picture that someone invited me to sign for them, and I go, oh, I didn't look so old then. Or, yeah, I look like I didn't feel as old as I feel now in that picture. It's lovely. You know, this is one of the really nice things I think about Potter, is that it's created so many different communities for people who love it and come together to share how they feel about it. That's one of the things I always love about conventions. You see that it creates bonds, not just between people who have read the books and the characters or seen the films and the characters, but also between people who share that in common. And that's us as well. It's a slightly different side of it, but it's the same difference. So, anything that gives us a chance to come together, catch up, maybe you haven't seen someone for a long time, you get the opportunity to, that's a lovely thing.
So we've got some questions lined up because we have a lot of Harry Potter fans here who are dying to get their questions in. So I want to open up the panel to our first question right in that corner. Hi, what's your name?
Hey, my name is Leah.
And you have hi, Lena. You have a question.
My question is, are there any other Harry Potter characters you would have liked to play?
Okay, so are there any other characters that you would have liked to play in the Harry Potter universe, I assume? So, Afshan, let's start with you. Is there any other character that you thought, like, this is the one I would try out?
I probably would have loved to play Bellatrix in, like, another life, just because she's just badass and I love her.
Yeah.
So probably, yeah, Bellatrix.
Are we going to go down the line?
We can do it, yeah, if you want, sure.
Snape. It's not the best part. Snape's the best part. You read the line, right? It's the best part. That's Harry's the best part. That'd be fun.
I would have liked to have played Dobby.
Oh, Yeah.
It would have been very strange, but I would have loved to have played Hagrid. Height difference, I know.
I wonder why.
Yeah?
Amazing.
I actually have terrible eyesight, so I feel like I would be great as the bus driver, the night bus driver.
I'd like to have had a stab at Malfoy, I think. I think it's always fun to play a villain, and, you know, slightly less annoying than Colin, and, you know, you get to kill Dumbledore as well. Spoilers, whatever. And, so, yeah. Well, at least popped a couple. Yeah, anyway, you know how it goes.
I would have loved to play Professor Trelawney, just because I think I look a bit like her.
I can really see you play Malfoy, actually. I think that's a good shout. Hermione?
Yes.
No, I think my favourite character is Gilderoy Lockhart, and I think we could have so much fun playing that part. Gilderoy Lockhart.
I would have said Bellatrix too, or Sirius Black.
A bit too, because I sort of did. Percy, because it was the first character that I auditioned for, and Tom Riddle, because I read in that character at the read-through for the second film, which was fun.
So thank you so much for your question.
Thank you!
Thanks. Bye!
First of all, welcome to Germany, and I wanted to ask what your favorite scene from Harry Potter is.
Favorite scene from Harry Potter? Do you have any that like stand out? That they're in, or just in general?
I don't understand what you say.
Oh, so a scene that they're in with their character, or just from Harry Potter? Just from Harry Potter in general. Favorite scene. Let's start with you, Sean.
I've only seen the ones that I'm in. So I don't know, only those scenes, I don't watch the rest.
Those are my favorites. I'm gonna say it with Scarlett.
We all had a lot of fun together when we were all working together, so I would say anything that was in the Great Hall was a lot of fun. I think the first time that we shot that, when we were all eating together, we had a great time.
Well, there's a lot to choose, but I remember we were all really chuffed when it was the Halloween scene, when the troll, Quirrell, comes running in, telling everyone that there's a troll downstairs. And the whole Great Hall, we were so used to, you know, just the Great Hall used to like smell really bad, rotten roast dinners, basically. Just have a horrible smell. And then we do the Halloween scene, and then there's just sweets everywhere, like, you name it, it's marshmallow, sweets, chocolate, and they literally said, go crazy. Like, literally just stuff your face. Yeah, that one.
Even though it's obviously incredibly sad, I really enjoyed filming the Dumbledore death scene, just because it was so beautifully done, and you could tell when it was happening that it would be such a big moment. And it was so cold, and it was just visually just amazing, so yeah.
I think one of my favorite scenes was in the last movie, when you got Harry standing there and he's confronting Snape, and then Snape points his wand at Harry, and Professor McGonagall steps in and she does a little duel with Snape. I thought that was pretty badass, so yeah, that's probably one of my favorites.
I mean, there are so many epic scenes to choose from, and obviously as the films go on, they get like darker and darker. But what I really liked about from 6 onwards, just because I was sort of on them and witnessed them sort of firsthand, I really liked the friendship that they kept with Harry and Ron, but like the really cheeky kind of teenage friendship. And there's one bit when they're fighting over the potions within the class, there's one brand new one and one tattered, and they look at each other. And then they both start scrambling for the book. And I just thought it's such a real, realistic moment that would happen like to any of our friends that, you know, I think 10 people I know that, yeah, they would fight like that over a book. So yeah, I really liked that, you know, in the darkness and the epicness of the films, there were these really funny comic moments that felt actually really real and that I think that everyone could relate to. So I think it was really cleverly, directed in that way.
I think my favorite is in the very last movie when Neville Longbottom puts the head of Nagini. I think I love Neville, he's one of my favorite characters, and the scene at the very the end, like saving, like that's my favorite scene.
So as a viewer, I only watched the last few films last Christmas. So that was fun, and I really enjoyed the scene with Harry and Hermione when they do the dance, right? And it's like, it's like a love scene, but it's not. It's just like they're best friends. And I don't know, I think I cried a little bit. It was really nice. Yeah.
That's nice. No, nice is nice, do you know what I mean? That's good. We don't have enough moments of niceness in the world, probably. What is... little political statement there. Probably my favourite scene. I reckon my favourite scene, I'm not really thinking of the film at this point, I'm thinking of the book. It's the whole sequence in the Chamber of Secrets. I just remember reading that when I was however old and being like, I was genuinely up all night reading that bit, and it was just so atmospheric and so exciting. And I suppose any time I watched the films, I didn't have that same distance that I had with the books, so I maybe lose myself in it in the same way. So that's what comes to mind for me.
For me, it was definitely the U-Ball scenes that we did. That's not me. Not me. Okay.
My technique.
Testing.
Michael. I get it.
Oh, we've got a winner.
Is it dead? Oh, it's always
battery dead.
There you go.
You answering the question.
Yeah, the U-Ball scenes I really enjoyed doing because the Great Hall was changed so differently and everyone was out of their school uniforms and dressed kind of better. So yeah, the U-Ball scenes I really enjoyed. And we had Jarvis Harper perform as well, so that was amazing.
So, your answers opened a little way to a quick poll because you only watched the last movies recently. Who of you, by show of hands, has seen all the films? Okay, good. Who's read all the books? Okay, fair enough. Thank you for your question. Hi.
Thank you.
Hello there. First of all, thanks to all of you for coming to Germany and giving us this great opportunity of spending some time with you. My question is for all of you, if you could take any character from any like movie or TV show to take them into Harry Potter, who would it be? It doesn't matter if it's kind of like Joe or if you want them to help you in the battle against Voldemort, so yeah.
Wow, what a great question.
Yeah.
Well then. That's
the
question's good. Think about it. Someone else
go
first.
Gimli from Lord of the Rings, 100%.
Oh, wow. Gimli. Lord of the Rings. The dwarf.
Gimli, Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, that's funny that you said that, because I was immediately thinking Gandalf, actually, and seeing how he would square off against Dumbledore. I don't know, I think some people are maybe Team Gandalf and some people are Team Dumbledore on that front. I don't know. But I think they'd get along.
Yeah. Any other favorites that stand out? Like a favorite character that you would love to have in battle against Voldemort? Like, I think Gandalf is a pretty high standard to have. Yeah, you can't beat that. Definitely. Thank you for your question. Who would you take to battle?
No matter what, I would always take Loki from Marvel.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Or all the Avengers to come and help Harry with the battle, that would be great.
Thanks so much. Hi.
Hi. We are very thankful that you came all the way here to Comic-Con. I'm not sure if these questions were mentioned, but I have two of them. And we hope that you enjoy this day as well. So the first question is, what was your experience like while you were filming in Harry Potter movies? Was it this kind of experience that you enjoyed particularly?
Can you repeat the last part? What was your experience like when you?
When you were filming in Harry Potter movies, was this kind of experience that you enjoyed while filming?
Who wants to go first? Yep, Scarlett.
It was really amazing. I started shooting just before my 17th birthday. So when I joined, it was nice because we had a whole bunch of us who were starting at the same time, and it really did feel like going to school. And it was, I would say, well, advanced school, it's a magical school. No, it was really amazing, and I'm very grateful because it was one of the reasons that made me want to continue pursuing acting. And we got to make wonderful relationships and, you know, learn from the best. So I'll always be very grateful for that time.
Well, I never had any kind of preconceptions about it because I didn't really know what Harry Potter was until the audition for the film came up. So when we started, I had no preconceptions. The only time I've ever done anything where it already existed and I had an idea of what it was going to be like was when I did an episode of Good Omens that's going to be on in the summer. And that was really crazy because I was walking into a universe that I'd already seen before, like what it must have been like for you guys coming onto Harry Potter. It was making a movie but just on a bigger scale and more magnificent than anything else I'd ever done before.
No, I was just going to add to say, like, for me personally, it was like the best years of my life. Like, I can speak for everyone. Like, we are very, very lucky to be a part of the Harry Potter universe and filming every day. You only have each other. Like, we went to class together, we went to school together on set. So we kind of understood each other. We had so much fun. And the food on set was incredible. So. Yeah, we had the best catering team and just the best crew and the best set. I know it's cliche, but it kind of goes to show like how many years later we're all still here.
Reminded me of something. Sorry, just as a quick interjection, I was thinking, oh yeah, I agree with whatever it said. I was like, the food thing. I'm like, yeah, we had sushi in the
canteen. And it was unlimited free.
That was good. When I was a student, I used to take my packs home to my friend, be like, a bit rubbing it.
We don't like that.
The students can eat.
Yeah. We all did.
Thanks so much for your question.
Okay, so my...
Oh yeah, you had a second question. Go ahead. Yeah.
Okay, so my next question is, what do you think, what was the best Harry Potter movie film so far to you?
What was the best Harry Potter movie? Wow, that's like, tough question. What do you think is the best Harry Potter movie?
Yes.
Or as an experience or as a film? Good question, yeah. I kind of want to say as a film?
Okay. Yes.
I was going to go the other way as an experience, but as a film, which one is the best or your favorite?
I like Deathly Hallows Part 1.
Yeah, you know what? I'm going to join you on that. Yeah.
Why?
Thank you very much.
Yeah, it was just definitely like totally different feel from any of the other movies. It was this like weird little road movie. It was just a nice change of pace.
It's really the part where it's the coming of age story, I think, where it changes into, like, I don't want to say adulthood, but on the way to like a building storm or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah, I think for similar reasons I've liked the third one a lot because it was just that different tone to it and different style of Alfonso Cuarón coming in and making it kind of just the wacky stuff that was in there, just kind of random. I quite like that about it. I don't know.
My favourite was Azkaban. Because, you know, even though the first two movies were amazing, they felt a little bit sort of, you know, the Chris Columbus-y, like kind of, I don't know, just a bit kind of glossy. And then Alfonso Cuarón turns up, just like flips everything like on its head in a way, because he just brought an element of realism to it, which I really appreciated. So like first two movies, everything was perfect. Top buttons had to be done up and straight ties. And then Alfonso comes on, he's like, undo it. Some people with jumpers, some people not. Crooked ties, you know, and it just added this little sprinkled some realism into it. I like that.
I've got to go with the very first movie. It's the first time we get to experience any of the Wizarding World. First time we see Hogwarts. The first time we get to meet any of the characters. And for me, it's just the most magical movie of them all. And it's like welcoming everybody. And I think Chris just did an amazing job. And also for me, like, the first movie was just so much fun. Like, we all started, myself, Alfie, and Josh, when we were like 11 years old. And it was just playing. Like, it wasn't work, it was just playing all day, every day. And I think that's what makes it even more special for me.
And like, Devin, you and Josh were, of course, part of our first glance into that world of Hogwarts. When we step into that world, but it was for you, it was also the first time you saw Hogwarts, because I read somewhere that you weren't allowed on set beforehand just to keep it magical. What was that like for the three of you as actors, to go into that world as a child and, you know, action, go, like?
Yeah, well, I mean, for me it was mad because the only thing I'd done before was a play. So I'd never worked on screen, and I'd never seen sets, you know, realized on that kind of scale. And it was special for me for all the reasons that Devin said. But also on top of that, I was a fan of the books before I got part in the film. I'd read, I think the first two books had come out. So I'd read them both and like was completely hooked. So like for me, I was like, whoa, this is, you know, it was amazing. And those sets are incredible. You know, if anyone's had the chance to go to the studio tour, I mean, the craftsmanship, you know, the thing about that endeavor that I found so amazing was, I think that is an interesting thing to do, even if you're not a Harry Potter fan, because it's an amazing insight into how you make a $200 million film. You know, all the different departments, all the work, all the specialty, all the expertise, all the craftsmanship. But for me, the thing that always brought that home was the sets, man. I mean, some of the sets, you're just like, this has been, you know, you go around the back and there's also wood or something, but, you know, it's all been rendered in the most kind of magnificent and splendor. So yeah, it was amazing to walk up to those things the first time.
Yeah, like I didn't have a clue what I was getting into. I'd never read Harry Potter, I'd never heard of it. So in fact, the reason how I got my part is my character was cast as an English boy. J.K. Rowling said no, they flew me over. I had no idea what was going on, and I thought the director's name was Harry Potter. So I walked over to Chris Columbus and I said, "Hi, Harry Potter, I'm Devin Murray, nice to meet you." And that's how I got my part. They were looking for a stupid Irish kid and they got a stupid Irish kid. Yeah. So like, I had no idea what I was getting myself into, and then all of a sudden I'm like on these sets that are just like incredible, like out of this world. I've done small Irish movies before, like small scale. And all of a sudden I'm walking into the great hall that they've made in a studio. They've got Hagrid's bush down by the runway. And it's like, oh my god, this is going to be a pretty big movie. So I was just blown away.
Thank you for your answers. Enjoy the stay.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello. Thank you that you all are today here. And my question is, have your character that you are playing changed yourself?
Can you repeat the question, sorry, into the microphone, have you?
My question is, have your character that you are playing changed yourself?
Oh, okay, so how much of your character influenced you as a person or an actor? Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I played a photographer and I'm now a photographer, so the argument could be made. But I actually don't think that that's actually related. I think it's more of a coincidence. That's what I'm telling myself anyway. Maybe it was subconscious. Maybe I got a camera in my hands and just thought, you know what, this feels right. And then, you know, 15 years later, I decided to become a photographer. But yeah, I don't think so anyway. I don't know about anyone else.
I think it's like being in that world, intrinsically it affects your life. Either going through all seven films or getting into this world of fandom, it must have impacted your life in to a certain degree.
Yeah, it's not so much the character, it was just the general experience. You know, obviously 10 years being such a high profile movie, yes. I'm sure we all do often think, where would we be and what would we be doing if we hadn't got the parts, you know?
When was the moment you really felt like, wow, this is going to be huge? Now, of course, the books were immensely popular, but when a film comes out, you never know like how much.
Me, personally, I started on the fourth film, so already three films were already out. So on the fourth film, there was a lot of new characters introduced. The Bold Battle of the Durmstrang, Cho Chang, the Patel Twins, a lot of new ones. But I think the premiere of the film is when I realized, oh my God. Like, just having like the news on the back and just hearing on the news that people are queuing for days and like camping outside, like I think when you're actually on set you don't realize what's outside of set. It's just kind of your little bubble, as it were, like but come the premiere you realize, oh my God, I'm in Harry Potter, like this is big. And yeah, I think it's just like the fans and the dedication and loyalty that we have, like we wouldn't be sat here 20 odd days later if it wasn't for how much love that we get.
Yeah. It was the same for me, yeah, the premiere. And I remember the first movie, I got out of the car at the premiere and like the crowd were like screaming my name, and it hadn't been released yet.
That baffled
me.
And that was before, like, not to age us there, Josh, but that was before, like, everyone had, like, the internet on their phone and stuff. And I had exactly the same thing. I stepped out of the car, I was like, how do these people know what I'm called? I still haven't understood the answer to that question.
Amazing. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Hi.
First of all, I want to say thank you to all of you for being such a big part of my childhood and teenage years. And my question is, do you have a favorite Hogwarts teacher?
I like Professor Sprout. I think she's my favorite. Partly because I love Miriam as well. And just a little bit of her comes out in Professor Sprout, I think. Yeah, she's probably my favorite.
Yeah.
Someone? Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Favorite teacher? Maybe Trelawney. Because she reminds me of Jesse. No, I like the whole, if I'm remembering this rightly, the whole, you know, she's a bit kooky and she's a bit off the deep end, and maybe some percentage of what she's saying is nonsense, but she does have this gift, doesn't she, of prophecy, which occasionally, sometimes she's talking nonsense, but sometimes it's right. And I think there's a really fun like lesson to that. It was like, oh, it could just be some slightly bad stuff that probably has nothing to do with anything, or it could be a really profound prophecy that does you.
You never know.
Quite profound. Yeah, exactly. I find that quite fun. That's quite
a little surprise.
Though. Yeah, right.
Thanks so much.
Hi. Thank you for being here. And my question is, what do you think about the Harry Potter reboot series?
Okay, the Harry Potter TV series, right? That's your question. What do you think about it?
Well, I think it's awesome. I think it's a great idea. You know, because they can explore the universe more, and you know, if one film is going to equal one season, just think of all the stuff which they can put in, which they didn't have time to keep in the movies. It was a great idea.
Would anyone want to, of you want to revisit that universe, maybe as one of the teachers at Hogwarts? And what subject would you like to teach?
I'm actually really curious of this. I don't think we can possibly be objective or honest about that question. What I'd really like to hear is, are you guys excited about that?
Are you guys excited about the TV show?
Put your hands up if you're excited about the TV show.
Hands in the air if you're excited.
Okay.
Hands in the air if you say, don't touch my Harry Potter film universe.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so does your opinion change if we take the cast and put them in professor roles? Who's going to watch the TV show then? There we go. Yeah, okay. No big fans of the TV show, so that's a compliment to what you guys accomplished, I would say, definitely.
Can I ask, does anyone remember, I'm kind of interested with the same question in terms of people's relationship with the book and the film, if anyone is, you know, if anyone is not so young as to have grown, been discovered Harry Potter through the films, because did anyone, yeah, exactly, was anyone worried about them making films of it because they love the books?
Has your opinion changed when you saw the films? Say yes.
Yes, exactly. But it's difficult, isn't it? That's a real thing. When you have something, you have a relationship and you love, and someone reinterprets it, you're like, why are you touching my thing? And I think that's a... It's complicated. Right. I'll take you on that. But like, there's a kind of questionable thing with that, isn't it? Because you have to... People always used to say at the beginning, they used to be like, but where's Peeves? And where's this? And where's that? And I always used to say, it's not a filmed version of the book that you interpreted when you imagined it yourself. Someone has to make a take, do you know what I mean? Every version of something is a reimagining. Every version of something is something new. And you have to kind of accept that
it's going to be... Everyone's going to be happy with it either way. There are going to be people...
That is also very true.
It's completely natural, right? I remember like at the read-through of the first film, I was like, why are they saying Hermione? It's Hermione. Do you know
what I thought?
I never heard that name. And I was like, that's how I said it in my head. And I was cross. You know, you get attached to things you have a relationship with, but
I think also though it's nostalgic, so like you remember where you were and what you were doing when you read the books or when you saw the films. So in a way I feel like the TV series isn't going to be made for us. It's made for a whole new audience to bring more people into that world. So I feel like that's amazing, to pull more people into the culture and community of what Harry Potter is and the fandom. So I feel like it's a good thing. I only just found out that this was happening, so I'm excited.
I agree, and I completely agree with what Josh says as well, that through the TV series you get to explore some uncharted territory that was in the books but not necessarily in the films, because you only have like two hours max, which will be interesting to see how younger audiences will respond to that as well, definitely. So thank you so much. We're gonna do one more question because we're almost out of time, but then we've got one final surprise for you as well. So thank you for your question. Final question. Hi.
Hi. So my question is...
Oh, can you speak into the microphone, please? Thank you.
Why did you decide to go to the casting of Harry Potter?
Why did you?
Decide what? To go to the casting.
Okay, decide to audition for the film. So let's start.
So for me personally, like I said, I started on the fourth film, so I was a huge fan pre-auditioning, and... the casting agents came to my school and auditioned girls to play the Tattle Twins all around England and United Kingdom. And I went in as a joke, so I thought, Harry Potter, like, there's no way I'm gonna get it. And then, 12 auditions later, I got it. So I went in as a joke because I was the biggest fan. Best joke ever, yeah.
I went because they asked me. I actually didn't go the first time they came to my school. I was like, no, I just need that. Not because I didn't want to, because I thought I wouldn't get it. And then someone from the casting team saw me in something and they asked me to audition, and I thought it would be rude to say no.
Yeah, I was like doing part-time drama classes in the evening, and they came to the school and said, you know, do you want to audition? And you don't really say no when you want to be an actress, right? We didn't know what it was for. I think they just said it was a Warner Brothers film. Had no idea, but I was like, yeah, I'll go for it. And then I remember having to do cartwheels and roly-polies. Yeah, and then Chris Columbus, the director, just said, okay, cool, you're gonna be Angelina Johnson and play Quidditch. I had no clue what that meant, but I was like, cool, great.
Yeah, I just got a phone call to ask if I'd do a screen test for Harry Potter, and I said, yeah, it was a job, and I was 11 years old. I wanted to buy horses, so I said, of course I will.
I was actually auditioning for a completely different project, and Fiona Weir, the casting director, said to me, oh, I'm also casting for this other film. Would you mind staying half an hour? Can you look over the scenes? Would you come back into the audition room in like half an hour? I was like, yeah. And she handed me the scenes and walked out, sat in the waiting room and looked down and just saw Harry, Ron, Hermione, and I was like, and just remember texting my sister being like, gotta stay calm, but... and I originally read for Lavender Brown, because she was casting at the time for Lavender, but kind of left feeling that I wasn't quite right for the part, but you know, it was a lovely experience. And then had a phone call a couple of weeks later to say, could I come back and read Katie Bell? And then a couple of weeks later, yeah, had the call that I got the part, which was lovely. Here we are.
Yeah, it's interesting how we all have such different stories about how we got into it. Like, there's no one kind of route that we all took. So yeah, so I basically responded to an advert that came up in my school and it was like, yeah, casting for the Harry Potter film. And at this point, I think the first one hadn't come out yet, or had only just come out. Something like, basically, I didn't know how big a deal it was. But yeah, I just kind of auditioned with some, basically, I sent off to, I think we had to write some kind of letter or something. And it was just me and a few other people from my school, and yeah, we basically just did it for a laugh. I ended up, my first audition was for Justin Finch Fletchley, I think one of the Hufflepuff characters, and then like months went, I think it was months that went by, and I assumed I then got it, and then got a call saying, would you like to come and meet Chris Columbus and audition for Colin Creevy? So yeah, it was weird.
Yeah, we all had such different experiences. I was 20 and auditioning for something else, and they asked if I would audition for this, and again, weeks went by, and then they announced they were doing open auditions where over 7,000 girls auditioned for Lavender Brown, and then they rang me and said, you have a screen test, and I had to improvise with Rupert, which was, I think, the best experience of the whole thing for me. It was so ridiculous. And then I got the part, but it does feel like winning a lottery, really.
So I auditioned for Dudley, and I think I had about maybe four or five auditions for Dudley. Even had screen tests with Dan. And I don't know if Dan had been cast or not, but got down to the last two, and then they decided to go in a different direction. So didn't get that, I was heartbroken, and then I think about 3 weeks went by, they said, come back and try for Coyle. My dad, he's in the industry as well, he said, no, they've seen you enough, this should be an offer. My mum was like, he's going. So we went to the audition, and Tom Felton and Jamie Whalen had already been cast, so I had to complete the trio, basically. There was a bunch of other potential Goyles there, and I only actually found this out fairly recently, that I went in the room, and they'd send me out, send another one in, just to stand next to Tom and Jamie. And yeah, so what happened, they got all the kids out, and David Heyman and Chris Columbus, you know, the execs, they couldn't make their mind up, they couldn't decide. So they asked Tom and Jamie, they said, who do you want to be the you know, to complete the trio? And basically, yeah, Tom and Jamie picked me, so yeah, they cast me anyway.
Oh, that's
all
good.
That's really
good.
For me, I had originally auditioned for Luna Lovegood the previous year,
and then obviously didn't get that. A year later I got called back in for Pansy, and then I had a couple callbacks, and then I ended up doing a screen test with Tom, and it went really well, and then I ended up getting it, but I didn't hear for weeks later. I think it was almost the end of the summer that they told me, and then went in for the table read, which was really amazing. They got to meet everyone, and that was it.
I feel like I'm the only person that had a normal audition experience for Harry Potter. I mean, like Major called me up and said, I'm going to audition for this film. I said, okay. And I went and met the casting director, and she liked me, so then I went and met the director, and then I got the job. And I was like, everyone else has got these like epic tales of what, and then I didn't get it, and then I didn't.
That's also a possibility, right? So. Guys, I know we had to disappoint a few people who still have some questions, but we're on a really tight schedule. Fortunately, you're still going to be here, so if you have questions, make sure you go to the signing table, get your question. Just one more, okay. Final one.
What was the funniest situation at set?
Okay, so, funniest situation on set.
When the owl flew into the flames.
I was gonna say.
Do you remember that?
Yeah. That was my one.
Yeah.
I have a story.
I was gonna say anything to do with Alfie.
I have a funny story.
I mean,
Go ahead.
Alfie ran around all the sets naked, guys. All the sets. Oh no, nobody laughed, nobody cares. But basically, yeah, I just remember that. That's the great story. You gotta be there, you know? You ran around the sets all naked.
Were
you not there?
Yeah.
We'll find the CCTV.
I have to imagine that you played a lot of pranks on each other, or others played pranks.
We had a lot of free time as well, so, you know, when you were on set, as much as it was really fun, because it's a huge movie set where, you know, time is quite tight, and obviously, with any film set you're on, there will always be moments where you're waiting around or things overrun. So when you're on set, you have to be quite like ready in a way to like kind of get on with the scene.
You guys make a music video.
But, yeah.
We had
2 days where we were called in. We all got ready, got our costumes on, and they were like, "We don't need you just yet. It might be like another hour." And then an hour went by. "We don't need you just yet. Really sorry. Just waiting around, guys." And this went on for like a couple of days, which is expected. It happens all the time. But Afshan had like, again, this is showing our age. We had a laptop that had a camera at the front.
This was pre
and it was very media. So we set the camera up in the green room and just
me and Alfie
all these lip sync videos. And there's one of there's an 80s band, 80s band called Spandau Ballet, and we did a whole music video to one of their songs called Gold.
I'll get up again.
There's a lot of kind of like funny stuff.
And like on the set, and when we go to class as well, like me and Alfie were in the class together, like in school, because we still have to do our schooling. And we just have so much fun. We just misbehave for no reason, and the teachers hated us. But we just, we had a good time.
Must have been hell for some of the older actors who were like, "Let's just get the job done."
That's like offset.
Yeah, true. So, thanks so much for your question. Guys, we could talk for hours,
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
One final request. So, we want to invite the audience to. And wait for the instructions to take one big photo with all of you. So I'm going to invite the lovely Jenna on stage. Give it up for our photographer, Jenna. And if you can all just stay where you are, but stand up if you can. And then we're going to invite all of you in the front. So Jenna can sit in front of us. And I'll take the social video so everyone can see it back home.